face, so like a child I climbed a sycamore tree. When the kind man called my name, I knew I'd never be the same. Cause when the kind man passes by, the blind will see and the dead will rise, redeemed will dance and broken wings take flight. When the kind man passes by,
secrets to religion, drag my shame into the light. All my darkness was revealed just when I thought my fate was sealed. My accusers dropped their stones and walked away. Cause when the gunman cleansed my name, I knew I'd never be the same.
Cause when the gunman and the dead will rise, redeemed will dance and broken wings take flight. When the God man passes by, you can come just as you are. Let him have your broken heart. You have never run too far. There is freedom in his scars. You can come just as you are. Let him have your broken heart. You have never run too far. There is freedom in his scars. Cause when the God man redeemed will dance and broken wings take flight. When the God man passes by, when the God man passes by.
Hold me for all you are. I lay have a song that the angels can't sing. You saved my weary soul from all my sin and pain and suffering. A song of the redeemed I once was lost, but you found me. Oh, I have a song that the angels can't sing. I have a song that the angels can't sing. You stepped out of your throne all wrapped in flesh. You made yourself like me. A song I couldn't reach, so you reached me. Oh, I have a song that the angels can't sing.
Testing. That's good right there. Good. That might be too much, but you can take it down if you need to. All right, peace, amen. Stand your feet if you would, please. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Chuck, if you can come and be ready to play something for us. I think we're going to do a little shaking hands if everybody's comfortable with that. So let's go to the Lord in prayer, and then we'll get to that. Lord, thank you so much for your love for us. Thank you so much for saving us. God, I just pray that tonight, Lord, that we would just... invite you tonight, Lord, to be our King. Lord, I just pray, God, that you just remind us of who you are, what you've done. God, what you mean to us. God, throughout eternity, what your sacrifice, Lord, just provides for us. And so, Lord, it's just a tremendous blessing and a privilege to be a Christian. God, I pray that we would never get over just being a believer. God, just knowing that the God of this world once blinded our eyes and then the glorious gospel opened our eyes and your spirit, Lord, has regenerated us through the power of the gospel. So, Lord, I pray that we would just be as excited about it today as we've ever been. Lord, I pray as we join together, Lord, I pray that as we shake hands and as we, Lord, greet one another tonight in the name of Jesus, Lord, I pray that you just bring a special unity to our group tonight. God, be with our children, Lord, tonight as they practice for their play. God, I pray that you would just give them Lord, clarity tonight. Lord, I pray that you give our workers patience. Lord, be with our youth workers tonight. God, I just pray that you do a work there. Lord, we love you so much. We always ask it, of course, in the name that's above every name, the name of Jesus. And all God's people said, amen and amen. All right, Chuck, if you'll play through and just turn around and shake hands, if you would, please.
Good evening, church. Let's sing an old song tonight, can we? Oh, sing, O victory. victory in Jesus. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing blood. And I heard about a story, how a Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood's atoning. Then I repented of my sins and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He saw me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He punished me to victory beneath the cleansing blood. And I heard about his healing, of his blessed path revealing, how he made the lame to walk again, and caused the blind to see. And then I cried, dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. And somehow Jesus came and brought to me the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He saw me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing blood. I heard about a mansion he has built for me in glory, and I heard about the streets of gold beyond the crystal sea, about the angels singing and the old redemption story. And some sweet day I'll sing up there the song of victory. Beneath the cleansing blood. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He punched me to victory beneath the cleansing blood. Amen. Thank you.
to worship, and here we are to bow down. Here we are to say that
you're our God.
You're our God.
And you're all to
if you will tonight, if you'll take out your Bible, we are going to be looking at some messages on Solomon. I'm a little nervous tonight for this reason, the message tonight and the message I'm going to be, as I begin Solomon, I'm closing out David. And so I'm closing out David on Sunday morning, passing the torch. I'm calling it Torches and Trees. And then tonight, we're beginning Solomon. And so we're kind of doing this backwards, and I'm a little bit leery that I'm going to get confused on what I'm supposed to be talking about tonight, what I'm supposed to be talking about Sunday morning. So if we overlap a little bit, y'all would just have to forgive me. But we're in 1 Kings chapter 2. 1 Kings chapter 2 tonight, we'll be looking at verses 1 through 4. While you're turning there, you know, back in August of 1985, August the 12th, 1985, Japan Airlines experienced the most deadly airline accident in aviation history. On board were 509 passengers, 15 crew members. There was 524 people on this plane altogether. Just 12 minutes into the flight, the plane began to experience some major problems. The rear stabilizer, it malfunctioned, and for just about 30 minutes, if you can imagine this, the people on board were in a complete state of panic, in a complete state of utter horror. Some screamed while others just put their life preservers on and they just bowed forward. Now we know these specifics, you know, because sometimes you say, well, you know, if all these people died, how in the world do you know what was going on the plane? Well, fantastically and miraculously, we know these specifics because of the 524 people that were on board this plane, four people survived the fatal crash. And ironically enough, all of them were female passengers seated halfway back on the right side. But during this erratic descent of this Boeing 747, this huge airplane, one man whose name was Hiratsuga Kawaguchi, he did something totally unique. While everybody else was panicking or everybody else was, you know, just bowing forward, instead of succumbing to the horror, instead of succumbing to the pandemonium, what he did is he somehow had the presence of mind to sit there and to write a letter to his family about their future without him. I won't read the whole letter, but this is an excerpt of the letter that was found attached to his body at the crash site that he wrote during this crash, during this 30 minutes. This is what he said. He said, "I am very sad," he said, "but I am sure I won't make it. The plane is rolling around, descending rapidly. There was something like an explosion that triggered smoke." And then he wrote this to his oldest son. He said, "I am counting on you. You and the other children, be good to each other and work hard. Remember to help your mother." And then he wrote this to his wife. He says, "Please take care of yourself and the children." And then he wrote this. He said, "To think our dinner last night was our last, but," he said, "I am truly thankful for the happy life that I have enjoyed." Now think about that. This man knows he's going to die, and he writes this letter to his family. As I read these words, and as I was looking at this week, you know, we're just all amazed that a man that is facing certain death, that is surrounded by this horror, that under the most chaotic of circumstances, that he could possibly have the wherewithal to sit there and to pen these words. And, you know, this is the truth. Most of us will never have the opportunity to address our families in death. But I ask this question to you tonight. If you could, what course of direction would you give your family? And even more so, what course of action have you already set for your family? You know, because I really feel like that's something that we would write in our last words. I really feel like it's probably going to be a direct reflection of what we're already living and what we're already teaching and what we're already modeling and parenting and patterning for those that are around us. Three things to me stand out, you know, for sure. This is what I want my family to do. Number one, to know the way. Number two, to show the way. And number three, to go the way. I mean, those three things have to be true. Number one, my kids have to know the way. Number two, they have to be able to show the way, and then they have to be to go the way or be going the way. And so those three things that I have tried to do with my family. Know the way, for sure, you got to know, and then you have to show, and then you have to go. Those three things have to be true. But from our study of David's life, we understand to some degree the dysfunction Because we're going to be talking about Solomon and what Solomon is born into and what Solomon is walking into. So to some degree, if you've been paying attention to God's glory in David's story, then you also understand that David, to a large degree, he brought dysfunction into his family. And that is exactly the atmosphere and that is the dynamic to which Solomon was born into and to a large degree in what he was raised in. But you remember in David's dying days, just like this Japanese guy, David at least attempts to give Solomon what he knows in his mind to be clear and godly direction. And that's what I want to read for you today. Let's just read 1 Kings chapter 2 and let's look at verses 1 through 4. Now the days of David drew near that he should die, and he charged Solomon his son, saying, I go the way of all the earth. In other words, everybody's going to die and I'm going that way too. But he says this to Solomon. Listen to what he said. He said, Solomon, he said, be strong, therefore, and prove yourself a man, and keep the charge of the Lord your God, to walk in his ways, to keep his statutes, his commandments, his judgments, his testimonies, as it is written in the law of Moses, that you may prosper in all that you do, and wherever you turn, that the Lord may fulfill his word which he spoke concerning me, saying, and he repeats, if your sons take heed to their walk, to walk before me, the Lord says, in truth with all of their heart and with all of their soul, he said, you shall not lack a man on the throne of Israel. Now, in this passage, we see three things that encompass the idea of holiness. Number one, if you want to write these down, number one, it's courage. Number one, courage, something to fight for. David gives Solomon courage. Courage. He says, be courageous, have something to fight for. And I just say this to everybody tonight. What is it that you have in your life that you're so passionate about that you would fight for it? And by the way, is it worth fighting for? You remember what I've told you before, D.L. Moody said this and Francis Chan borrowed it later, but he simply said this. He said, don't fear failure. Fear being a success at something that doesn't matter. Isn't that a good statement? Don't fear failure. Fear being a success at something that doesn't matter. I just wonder how many people are passionate, how many people have given their life for something that when all is said and done and the smoke clears and the dust settles, that it doesn't count for anything. I mean, it's successful at something that doesn't matter. At the end of my life, I want to know that my life counted for something that matters, something that is going to be an investment in all of eternity, and I'll say more about that, on Sunday morning. But number one, have courage, something to fight for. Number two, character, something to live for. And number three, conviction, have something to die for. Everybody in this room, I hope you have are asking God for courage. Give me something to fight for. I want something, where I'm going to fight for my life. Not that you're going out looking for a fight, but there are so many things in our world today that need to be fought against. And we need to choose one of those things or some of those things to fight against. And then number two, character, something to live for. Something that, this is how I'm going to live. And then lastly, conviction, something to die for. I've mentioned in days gone by that we will never die for something that we won't live for. People say, well, I'm going to die for Jesus. You know, it's very interesting. The people that say, I'm going to die for Jesus, and they can't hardly live for Jesus. And I'm just of this persuasion. If I'm not going to live for something, I'm probably not going to die for something. If my heart is just not totally given over to living for Jesus, I'm probably not, if I'm called on to do so, I'm probably not going to die for Jesus. We only live and die for those things that we own. And I have said this so many times, and I've tried to just instill this in my sons, and to some degree I've succeeded, and to some degrees I've just been a failure, and I hate that. But the truth is, every generation just seems to go a little more left than the one before. Have you noticed that? It just seems that every generation goes a little further left. And as I watch my own sons, and I've brought them up, to believe as I believe, but I can see that even they are a little bit left on some things, further left on some things than I am. Jonathan, he's probably a little left on some things than I am. And Jared's a little left on some things than I am. And you've probably seen the same thing in your own children, that they're just a little bit left on some things. And, the thing is this, and I tell them this all the time. You are borrowing what I'm giving you, but sooner or later, you got to own something. You have to take ownership. You got to have the courage to fight for it, the character to live for it, the conviction to die for it. And you're not going to live for anything, fight for anything, or die for anything unless you own it yourself. Kids, so many times, they'll go through high school and they'll just kind of go along. But we really don't know what our kids are thinking. We really don't know what our kids are really, really owning until they get to where they can do exactly what they want to do. I didn't know what my kids were about until they got out of my house. One of them hadn't even got out of my house yet, but, you know, I hope I know which direction he's going, because he's coming here, you know, so he better be going a good direction. But the other one, you know, I know kind of where he's at now, and he's in a good place, and I want him in a better place, you know, and that God's going to have to do that work. But, you know, here's the thing, is that we have to have something in our own hearts, in our own lives, to die for, to fight for, to live for, that we might reproduce it in our children. And I just hope and pray that our young people will begin owning what we've owned in our generation as far as Christianity is concerned. Because if they do not, this world is going to chew them up and spit them out. And I hate to say that, but that is just the way it is. So I don't want my kids to be borrowers. And by the way, I don't want you to be a borrower. I shudder to think of the church members in churches that borrow from their pastors but do not own their own beliefs. And then when their own beliefs are challenged, they can't defend them. A lot of times, you know, people say, well, I'm going to call my pastor because I want to find out why I believe this. What? I'm going to call my pastor, so I want to find out why I believe this. Well, if that's what you're doing, then you don't believe it. You have to take ownership of it yourself. And that's why David told Solomon, he said, be a man. He said, walk in the statutes of God, not the opinions of man. Don't worry about what man is saying. You walk in the statutes of God. Take personal ownership of what you believe, Solomon. Solomon, this is what I've taught you, but that doesn't mean that it's in you. You have to adopt this and embrace this. You have to process this and absorb this yourself. You have to be that sponge that absorbs all of these truths from the law of Moses, because I can't make you believe that. I can only tell you what is true. So David was not saying to Solomon, make God your friend. And this is a danger that I have found, you know, in Christianity, is that everybody wants God to be their friend. And by the way, this world doesn't have a problem with God being your friend. Here's where this world's going to have a problem, and this is really where the rubber meets the road. This is the acid test. It's not, is he your friend? It's, is he your king? Him being your friend is one thing, and by the way, you need that. But the question is not, do you claim him as your friend? That's not far enough. It's when you claim him as your king. When you claim God as your friend, here's what you can do. You can just kind of pick and choose what part of his word you want to live by. And as long as he doesn't interfere with your schedule and he doesn't interfere with your comfort zone, then you will walk with him just like you do with your friends. There's a different relationship that you have with a friend and with your king. Because, ladies and gentlemen, when you declare him to be your king, your voice and your choice becomes his voice, or his choice, his voice and his choice becomes your voice and your choice. When he speaks, you listen. When he chooses, you choose. And there's no argument there. He chooses and you and I follow. Do you realize that this world does not care if you declared Jesus to be your friend? You know, they'll say, oh, that's nice. Jesus is my friend. Oh, that's nice, you know. But this world does mind if you declare him to be your king. And here's why. When you declare him to be your king, the world becomes your enemy. That's what they mind. If he's just your friend, then we're just going to run along here and everybody's just going to get along. But if he is your king, that means you have drawn the line in the sand somewhere, according to the word of God. And where you've drawn the line, I can assure you, if it's based on the word of God, it is not where this culture and where this world has drawn the line. Matter of fact, they don't even have lines. The lines have disappeared. The only lines, that's why that this world cannot stand Jesus as king. Oh, he's a great friend. Oh, he's a great historical figure. Oh, and there's certain parts of Jesus that we want to adopt, his kindness and his benevolence. But when it comes to his moral stand and where he stands on the gospel, we don't want to hear about that. And so when you say, Jesus is my friend, the world said, oh, that's nice. When you say, Jesus is my king, that's when they're going to take issue with you. And so David tells Solomon, he said, make God your king. Give him all of your heart. Notice he said, give him all of your soul. Implicitly, David was saying this, Solomon, do what I did or what I aspired to do most of the time, but don't do what I did a lot of the time. Because as we have seen, David is telling Solomon to do something that David himself didn't really do. David got to points in his life where he wasn't given God the throne in his heart or his soul. There were times when David became his own king instead of God being his king, and what a mess that turned out to be. So I say this tonight to dad, mom, parents, just because your kids are here at church tonight, that doesn't mean they know what's right. And for sure, that doesn't mean they know why it's right. I think that we as parents probably do a pretty good job on the what. I think that we fail on the why, don't you? Don't you think that we do a pretty good job on the what's right? But the why, that's the key. Because the why is where they move from borrowing to owning. If I know what, I can borrow. But if I know why, I can own. Because if the why makes sense, or if the why is according to God's word, then I'm going to own it. A lot of times people just say this, say, why is it wrong? I mean, I'm dealing with some situations right now, you know, where there's young people that gotten out of the house and then turned a different direction, and then they're asking, well, why is this wrong? Well, the Bible says it's wrong, you know. I mean, that's where we get it from. And so a lot of times, you know, we're able to say, this is wrong, this is wrong, this is wrong. Okay, if it's wrong, tell me why it's wrong. Why is it wrong? So David explained that both his prosperity and his posterity would be affected. Let me give those to you. Number one, prosperity. Prosperity in verse 3. He says this. He says that you may prosper. If you're going to prosper, you're going to have to walk with God, and he's going to have to be your king, and you're going to have to give him your heart and your soul. Number two, his posterity shall not lack a man on the throne. Now, what is that even talking about? You remember the Davidic covenant, where David was told by God that his throne would go on forever. Now that, ladies and gentlemen, is an incredible promise. And here's how that works. If you follow David's line, you have David, and then Solomon is his son. Now here's what happens, and I'll talk about this probably a little bit on Sunday morning, but I'm just going to give you kind of a brief snapshot of this. When Solomon became king, Solomon ruled over all 12 tribes. David had brought together all 12 tribes. He had unified all 12 tribes. Solomon, when he was handed the kingdom, he had all the 12 tribes of Israel. David had amazingly expanded the borders of Israel from 6,000 square miles to 60,000 square miles. I mean, it's just an incredible thing that David had done. And so when he handed it to Solomon, he handed Solomon a great kingdom. We'll talk about this as we work through Solomon's life, but when Solomon died, the kingdom was divided. 10.5 tribes to the north, 1.5 tribes to the south, Judah and half the tribe of Benjamin. The kingdom was divided. And as you follow through there, you know, here's what you'll find, though. Never one time, this is amazing, never one time on the throne in Jerusalem, throughout all of the history, Old Testament history of Israel, never one time did any monarch sit on the throne that was not a direct descendant of David. God made a promise to David. Now, the northern kingdom, all bets are off, man. It was all over the place. And, of course, you know, 722, Assyria comes in and takes over. The northern kingdom was crazy, crazy. However, the southern kingdom, not one king, not one monarch sat on that throne in Jerusalem that was not a descendant of David. And by the way, can I remind you, Jesus Christ is a descendant of David. And can I remind you, during the millennial reign of Christ, Jesus Christ will sit on the throne of David. That's why that this is so important. Shall not lock a man on the throne. Solomon, I want to remind you, David says, there was a covenant that God has made with me. It's an extension of the Abrahamic covenant, the Davidic covenant, where he promised that that my seed would be on the throne all the way to the Messiah, all the way to the millennium. He didn't understand all of this, and that David's throne would last forever. Why? Because Jesus is going to sit on the throne of David in Jerusalem. What a great promise. What a great promise. And just think about this. Out of the 40 kings that followed Solomon in both Israel and Judah, this is what's astounding to me. 40 kings followed Solomon. Now, not in Judah. You kind of cut them in half. You got about 20 to the north and about 20 to the south. But the 40 monarchs that followed Solomon, there's only 8 that were positive at all in leadership. No wonder they were in such a mess. All of those that ruled in Judah were of Solomon's line, while there were several family dynasties all through the northern kingdom from the tribes and families. But because Solomon did not continuously sow seeds of godliness, the kingdom split, and many of the descendants of Solomon, reigned in the northern kingdom as well. You know, it's just a mess. As for the northern kingdom, as far as it was concerned, Solomon doomed it to very poor and very unrelated leadership. I'll talk about that maybe a little bit on Sunday. But while the southern kingdom stayed in the family until the Babylonian captivity, the leadership wasn't a whole lot better. Like I mentioned, there's only 8 out of 40 kings, there's 8 that were any good. And these are the people of God. So we ask ourselves this question, why is all this so important? I mean, is there really a legitimate cause to love God as king with all of our hearts and with all of our souls and with all of our minds? And here's something to think about. You know, the United States of America used to pray for other nations. Do you realize that right now missionaries tell us that there are people in other nations praying for us? That's embarrassing. Not because they're praying for us, because thank God everybody needs prayer. But it's just simply that they see us now. We are seen now as a mission field from other churches in other countries. We used to be the Christian nation that was going to the other countries and trying to lead them to Jesus. And now they're praying for us because they see where we are. And it's a very, very sad thing. While other countries are being persecuted in their churches, you know what's happening in our churches? We're not being persecuted. We're just being seduced. And here's what's happening. We feel sorry for the other countries. We feel sorry for the communist countries where they have underground church, where those churches are being persecuted. But here's what's happening in those churches. Those churches are being persecuted, and those churches are getting stronger. We're being seduced, and we're getting weaker. And we're feeling sorry for them. We're the ones that's getting weaker. We're not getting stronger. The church in the United States of America is not getting stronger. It is getting weaker because we're being seduced by this world. And to some degree, we are succumbing to it. So when we think about these third world nations, and we think about these oppressed nations, and we think about how that they're being persecuted, don't feel sorry for them. Their church is getting stronger. Feel sorry for us because we're getting weaker. The church is designed to be what? Not an organization. We are designed to be an organism. An organism, a living organism. But we have become more of a business than we have anything else. And by the way, as I mentioned to you before, when a body becomes a business, what's that called? Prostitution. When a person makes a body into a business, that's called prostitution. And I'm afraid that even in the United States of America, as I'm watching some of these churches, they become more of a business. They become more of an organization than they are an organism. And what's happening is we're prostituting God. There's no shortage of pastors out there who are using God to build their name instead of allowing God to use them to build his name. I do not want to be that preacher that's building a name for John Bowman, because who gives a rip about John Bowman? How about this? Let's turn it all to Jesus. And let's keep it there. That's where it's got to go, and that's where it's got to stay. But now the church has become all but obsolete in our culture. And I'm fearing this because in our country, our church needs to be strong. But because we're weak and because we're spoiled, the agendas of this world, they're taking over. Do you remember the church at Smyrna? And I don't have time to go into this, but you remember Revelation chapter 2, the church at Smyrna. You remember what was said about the church at Smyrna? The church at Smyrna was persecuted, and it was poor in Asia Minor in that culture. But the Bible says this, they were rich in Jesus. Now, that's representative of some of these third world and some of these communist, and these oppressed nations that had these underground churches. Smyrna represents that. When you go into Revelation, you see those seven churches of Asia Minor, and you see the church at Smyrna, read about it. They were poor. The Bible says they were just dirt poor, and they were persecuted horribly, and yet the Bible says that even though they were poor as far as the world is concerned, they were rich as far as Jesus was concerned, because they themselves were getting stronger through the persecution. You know, there was a day in our country, and some of you will remember this, there was a day when sin was actually condemned in this country. I mean, not just by the church. How many of you remember when sin was actually condemned just by rank-and-file people, you know? And I use that term loosely, but you know what I'm saying? I mean, you remember that. You remember that 50, 60 years ago, man, sin began to be accepted. And ladies and gentlemen, here's what's happened today. Now it's being celebrated. That's what's sad. That's kind of the indicators, you know, and that's kind of the flag wavers in our nation, is that now what used to be condemned, here's what happened, this has happened in my lifetime, there were certain things that were condemned, and by condemned, I don't necessarily mean that in a bad way, But even just your regular common person that never darkened the door of a church would condemn certain things. It was just not right. And then throughout the 80s, we watched as it was kind of being condoned. And then now in our lifetime, you and I are being called on to celebrate it. There's parades. There's gatherings. Let's celebrate this thing. Let's celebrate. And God in heaven is not celebrating. God in heaven has still considers it to be an abomination. And by, when I say it, I can be talking about several different things here. You can fill in the blanks. You know exactly what I'm talking about. You know the things that used to be condemned and used to be looked down upon and used to be, you know, man, you'd keep that in the closet. Did I say that? In the closet. You keep that in the closet. And now, what do? Well, yeah, let's just bring it out and let's just celebrate it. So, somewhere along the line, you know, we dropped the ball as the church. But Jesus said this would happen. But here's the thing. If we have made Jesus our king, we're not going to celebrate sin. You can't. You cannot. If you've made Jesus your king, you cannot celebrate sin. In this world, we will not tolerate sin in our lives. And by the way, there's still a bunch of people out there. Sometimes we get that Elijah syndrome where we think, well, we're the last one standing. We're not. This afternoon, Chad, myself, and my mom, we went car shopping. Chad's our body guy, you know. Chad, if I need somebody to look at a car, Chad can look at a car. And, you know, even today he was looking at a car and said, "Nope, that ain't it," you know, because he can see, you know, all the little things that I can't see and knows what to look. But Chad, you know, today we're car shopping. We go down to Greensboro. We drive an Acura. My mama said, you know, she said, "Whatever car I've got, that's what I'm getting again," because, you know, for her to go through what she went through and to come out without a scratch. You know, she said, "I'm getting that kind of car." And I said, "Mom, the car's great, but it was God." Somebody say amen, you know. And she knows that. She knows that. But she's still going to get a good car. So she loved that Acura. So we ended up buying a white Acura today. But this is what was interesting. The woman that was, the one that was dealing with us today, we were at Jerry Hunt down in, what was it, Lexington? Is that where we were at? All right. I always try to get in a conversation with people and try to find out if they're a believer. And then I just noticed as I sat down, she had on the back of her computer Jeremiah 29:11. Well, there's a really good sign right there, you know. And so I started talking to her about the Lord. And man, you know, as she's talking back, it took us probably forever to get these papers signed because we were just talking about church, talking about the Lord, and talking about, you know, just what God has done in our life. Well, then they sent us to the back. Well, I got to the back, and a guy named Chris. So I said, "I'm with Mom. She's got to sign some more papers." You know how it is when you buy a car. And so we're sitting back there. And so I try to get in a conversation with him. And as I'm getting in a conversation with him, you know, I always try to bring up something spiritual, just trying to see if somebody, if they know the Lord or not, you know. And man, just as soon as I start talking, he says, "Yep, you know what?" And then he starts talking about the Lord. I mean, we're having open conversations today about the Lord. And it occurred to me today that everybody's not lost, and everybody, we haven't lost everybody. There's still good people out there, godly people out there that love Jesus. And I think sometimes we get the idea, well, we're the last one standing. Well, we might be at some point. But there's still a bunch of people out there that still love Jesus and still want to see the light of the gospel shine. And so, you know, and that's just good news. That's just good news. And I was so encouraged today. How many of you watch Fox News? Anybody? I got bad news for you. That doesn't mean you're right with God. Sorry. Now, I watch Fox News sometimes too, but, you know, here's the thing. Don't let Fox News become your devotions. Because I talk to people sometimes, you know, and I'm not saying that about any of you that raised your hand, because, you know, my mama's probably sitting there watching it right now. But the thing is that, you know, sometimes we think Fox News is Christian. It's not. It's not. The Republican Party is not the Christian party. Fox News is not the Christian news. So don't let that influence you so much. It's fine, they're conservative, and I'm okay with that, obviously, you know. But here's the thing. That is not Christianity. Christianity is getting along with God. Christianity is getting along with God and saying, "Lord, you are my king." And that's why we have to be people of the book. We have to be people of the book. the book that enables us, the book that empowers us, the book that tells us not to run from the fight, but to run to the fight. If there's a fight, ladies and gentlemen, run to it. We cannot withdraw. We cannot quarantine forever. We have to engage with God as our friend, but more so than that, we have to have God as our King. We talked recently, I mentioned to you about a sin alarm. All of us kind of have a sin alarm. Y'all know what that is? You know, it's kind of a conviction thing. Anybody ever have your sin alarm go off? Well, if you had it to go off, you know what you were doing? You were sinning, you know, so, or you were about to, or there was a temptation there. And so your sin alarm, by sin alarm, we're talking about that thing that's internally within all of us. It's that conscience, but it's the Holy Spirit using our conscience just to let us know that, you know, well, ladies and gentlemen, you know, there's certain things we have to say no to. And I'm afraid that we have succumbed so much, you know, to sin that we've even allowed our consciences to be seared. Think about this for a moment right now. What is going on in your life right now that you would not have allowed years ago? Now, let's be honest about something. If you grew up in a very, very legalistic environment, as I did, and as my wife did, and probably as many of you did, there were things that when you were brought up, and I'm not throwing off, I'm just being honest. There were things when you were brought up that was deemed a sin that wasn't a sin. And I know that some of you have had to work through that. My wife's had to work through that, certain things, you know. My mom has had to work through that. She freaked out, you know, the other day when she heard that I announced to the church that I went to see Chicago. She about had a heart attack because she thought, oh, my gosh, what in the world? And I said, Mama, what's wrong with Chicago, you know? But we grew up. Listen, when I grew up, man, if you went to see Chicago, you were a dirty, low-down, rotten heathen. And I'm like, Chicago? You know? My wife used to sneak off behind her parents' back and listen to Chicago and thought she was committing the cardinal sins, you know? And here's the thing, though, but there are certain things. I'll be honest with you, the night when I was at the Chicago concert, my sin alarm didn't go off. I will say this, though, it was kind of funny because I was about the youngest guy there. There was some old guy over there right beside of me, and he got out in the aisle and he was doing this. And he about fell over, you know. I thought I was going to have to go over and help him, you know. And I'm not sure I was doing it as good as he was doing. But, you know, here's the thing, though. There are certain things in our life, and I'm not talking about things that were legalistically implanted into you. And I'm talking about things that are just really wrong. Things that years ago maybe you wouldn't have been watching, you wouldn't have been listening to, a concert you wouldn't have gone to. Because it's just wrong. Clearly, blatantly wrong. I heard on the radio today where Iron Maiden is going to be in concert. Wrong. Wrong. You know? Wrong. Iron Maiden, it's out. AC/DC, it's out. But think about this, though. What are you allowing in your life right now that you know to be wrong, that you've allowed your conscience to be seared with a hot iron to the point that you don't think anything about it anymore? Maybe your sin alarm stopped going off because your conscience is so cauterized. And I just invite you to do something tonight. Would you be like the psalmist? Would you be like David of old? Would you say to God, Lord, if there be any wicked way in me, show me what it is. Cleanse my heart. God, make me sensitive to what is sensitive to you. Keep back thy servant also from presumptuous sin. Because God wants us to live holy. God wants us to live holy. You know, I entitled this message just simply this. I entitled it, you know, Canaries in the Coal Mine. And probably most of you know where that comes from. You remember, just in the old days, that's how, that when they go down into these mines, that's how they would know if there was any kind of gas or any kind of poisonous gas down there. What happens is you got little canaries, and you take the little canaries down there where their lung capacity is not near what ours is. So you could be down there, and you could be breathing some poisonous gas, and you wouldn't even know. And so what they would do is they'd take the little canaries, and they would go down, and they'd have them in a little cage, and they would go down and have the canaries there. If they noticed that the canaries started to die or started to struggle, then they knew that was a signal that they'd better get out of there. Because if those little canaries are dying, that means there's a poisonous gas somewhere in that atmosphere down there. And that poisonous gas, although it's not affecting you like it's affecting the canaries, it's affecting you some, and if you stay down there long enough, it will kill you too. And I do believe, you know, that we have ignored a lot of the canaries in the coal mine, so to speak, in our culture. And we've ignored it to the point that we just don't even deem it to be necessary. We see canaries dying all around us, and we just say, well, that won't happen to us. As a nation, we said it wouldn't happen to us. I don't know how many of you right now, you're a little bit leery about where we're going as a nation. And how many of you are more than a little bit leery? And so am I. But the main thing, infrastructure is one thing, morality is something else. Trillions of dollars is one thing, and that's a terrible thing. However, you know what? A nation can recover from trillions of dollars if God blesses that nation. You say, well, that takes a miracle. Well, he's in the miracle working business. But the first thing that has to be right is the morality. Because what does our Bible say? Righteousness exalts a nation. Sin is a reproach to any people. You know, I've probably told you this before, but one of the temptations that I have every time that I get alone and every time I start thinking just by myself, and every time I turn the news on, I have a temptation to run for office. I do. Because I'm still naive and ignorant enough to think that I could make a difference. Honestly, I've even thought, I know this is terrible, this is just me being crazy. I've even thought, man, I'd like to be president. Not because I want to be president, but just because I want to bring some sanity and I'm not even close to being qualified to be president. My foreign policy would be out there, you know. I can't even identify half the countries and where they are. Geography is not my strong point. They'd chew me up and spit me out on that. I'd have to surround my people with so many people that are so much smarter than I am. I'd just be the front guy just standing up there telling them what's what. I mean, that would be my campaign. But you know what? I have found this to be true. The people that are up there that are running aren't qualified either. And so I thought, maybe I'm overqualified, you know, because half of them, all they do is talk a good game too, you know. They don't know what they're doing either. But then there's also something inside of me that says this. And again, I'm not running for office. I have no intention of it. I actually had a businessman the other day that took me out to eat. He called me, took me out to eat, and that's exactly, he just said, I want you to do this. He said, I'm going to back you, and I can get you the financial backing for it. I said, I'm not doing it. He said, why? He said, don't you see that? I said, yeah, I see it. He said, don't you think, yeah, I probably could make a little difference. I don't know. He said, you can get elected. We can get you elected. And I said, I don't doubt that. I said, but here's the thing. I'm still not called to clean out the pond. I'm called to catch fish. And it's not that I'm against running for office. It's just not for me. Because at the end of the day, I'm afraid that I'll get so consumed with that I'll forget all about this. And again, I know there are good people up there, good men and women that are doing it. And I'm not saying I'll never do it. But I am saying that right now for me, I just want to see, I want to catch some more fish. And I want to disciple some more people. I want to reach some more people. And I feel like right now, this is where I need to be. The church is still the answer. Amen. You can fight with politics all you want to, but you know this, you only win about every couple of years. And then every couple of years you get new people in, and every 4 years you get a new president. And every time it happens, man, it's just like this all the time. And I need something that's this, and that is Jesus. Amen. And that's the gospel. And so I say this to you tonight, you know, again, I didn't mean that in any way critical. I appreciate, you know, the guy taking me out. I appreciate, you know, the confidence, and I appreciate people that are doing it. I just have to say this, though. I have to say that for John Bowman right now, I just want to make Jesus my king, and I just want to persuade some more people to do the same thing. And I hope that's true in your life. Is Jesus your friend? Amen. Hallelujah. That's great. Is he your king? That's another story. Remember, there's canaries in the coal mine, and when you see the canaries start dying, and they are dying around us, we need to understand this. Understand, if everything around us is starting to die, it's coming our way too. And we've got to stop this mess, and we've got to control the tide that is coming in of immorality, because it is about to take over. And David says to Solomon, he says, Solomon, give God your whole heart. Give God your whole soul. He's not just your friend. Make him your king. And if you'll do that, prosperity, posterity, both of those things God will take care of. Let's pray. Lord, don't pretend to have all the answers, but I claim to know the one who does. And Lord, as we look around and as we see all the canaries in the coal mine, Lord, as they're dropping like flies, Lord, help us not to ignore that. Help us to understand there's warning signs for a reason. And God, you've given us the warning signs. You've allowed us to see the canaries fall. Lord, if they're falling, Lord, it's coming for us too. Now, Lord, I just thank you tonight that as a church, that the gates of hell cannot prevail against us. I thank you tonight that we know who we have believed and we're persuaded that you're able to keep that which we've committed unto you against that day. Lord, our salvation is secure. And Lord, the church itself, Lord, cannot be overcome, Lord, by outside forces. God, I just pray, Lord, that like many churches, that we wouldn't succumb to what's going on inside. We wouldn't have internal problems, Lord, that would cause us to implode. Lord, we do politically want to see some great things happen. And Lord, I pray that you would call men and women, Lord, out of the church, Lord, to go and to represent, Lord, to stand where you stand, believing what you believe, owning, Lord, what you've given us to own. God, I do pray, Lord, that as a church and as our pastors, Lord, I pray that we would continue not just to say Jesus is my friend, but Lord, to declare you as our King, not just in theory, but God in lifestyle. Lord, we'll be very careful to thank you. Lord, we love you tonight, and tonight we say you are King. We ask this, of course, in the name of the King. His name is Jesus, and all God's people said. Amen and amen. You are dismissed tonight. Take us out with some music if you got some, Michelle. And just want to remind you of this. Sunday morning, we'll be just over the next few weeks. This is what's going on Sunday morning. Sunday morning, we will be closing out our David series. The next week, Pastor Jared will have communion. The next week, I'll have this Christmas service. So we're looking forward to it. Y'all are dismissed, or y'all are sent.